You're watching This Week in Horror. We talking The Walking Dead.
I love you, Lori.
That was excellent. That was absolutely excellent. And welcome to This Week in Horror. This week we are talking Walking Dead, as you just heard, and we are going all out tonight, man. Of course, I'm Matt Robb, welcoming you as usual. And don't forget to check us out on This Week In. We're on YouTube, iTunes, everywhere you can find us. And this week, I'm not joined by Stacey Lane Wilson. She is out on assignment, so we have found just a replacement. An upper replacement. Ladies and gentlemen, actress, scream queen, it's fun to say, and love of my life, Miss Brooke Lewis. Hi, how are you, Brooke?
Thank you, Matt, and thank you so much to my girl, Stacey Lane Wilson. I don't know if I can do a job like she can, but I will certainly try for all you viewers.
Well, we're going to try it out right here tonight, aren't we?
Thank you.
Of course, of course. Now, we've got lots of awesome stuff to get to. We're talking zombies, we're talking Walking Dead, and that's something that you're not really a stranger to, is that right?
Lately, I'm all, you know, usually I'm the vampirist, but lately I'm all about the zombies.
Yeah? Mm-hmm. You actually went all out in the zombie makeup once or twice, didn't you? Oh,
dude, it was the coolest thing ever.
Yeah?
I may give up my vampires just for zombies.
Whoa.
Yes, for the makeup effects design effects test over at Illusion Industries. I was so fortunate to spend an entire day. It took like, I mean, you know, I'm dying to know. Do you believe that? Is that
Look
insane?
Look at that. That is nuts.
It took four, that's me. It took
Damn.
4 hours to get into makeup, like 2 hours to get out.
Wow.
Those guys killed it, and I mean, it's just been incredible. Maybe I'll start getting cast as a zombie now. Who knows?
Yeah, no,
right?
I would love
Crazy,
it.
Crazy, huh?
I would love it. I'm actually going to stay up tonight because I'm a little intimidated. Look at that. There you are with Stacey.
Our girl.
There
Hi, Stacey.
Yeah, so you actually ate her. That's what happened. You
I
killed
did.
Her, and that's
I
why
did.
She's not here.
You weren't supposed to let the audience
oh.
know that.
Sorry, my apologies.
Mm-hmm.
So we are talking zombies and all things, just the undead today. And for those of you who have been under a rock for the past year or so and missed one of the biggest things on television in the past 6 months, a little network called AMC put on a little show called The Walking Dead, which is one of the highest rated cable TV series of recent history. And if you have not seen the trailer yet, we've got it for you, so just take a look.
Stay focused. Make sure you got a round of the chamber and you're safely up. Holy shit.
Put the gun down! Rick! He's hit!
You even know what's going on?
I woke up in the hospital. That's all I know.
Lori? Lori! Carl!
But you know about the dead people, right?
I saw a lot of that. Out on the loading dock, even tossed down the stairwell.
Not the ones they put down, the walkers. They were saying on the news some kind of virus.
Things got crazy.
Man, you won't believe the panic. The broadcast stopped. And that was the last we heard.
My wife and son, they're alive.
They got out of here. They're in Atlanta.
Why there?
Military protection, shelter, food. They told people to go there. Said they were working out how to solve this thing.
An
Atlanta sounds like a good deal.
Look, for one thing, they may not seem like much one at a time, but in a group all hungry.
Man, you watch your ass.
Broadcasting on emergency. Beautiful stuff. Excellent stuff. It's honestly probably one of the most powerful six episodes of television I've seen in a long time, and that's not even including the zombies that we got to see in every episode. It is out on DVD and Blu-ray this week, and I'd like to welcome our guest tonight, star Shane himself. John Berthal is in the house, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much. And you are joined by Boss in Venice. Is that
Boss
right?
Boss in Venice, yes. And these,
and these guys, of course, of course. And these guys were with you on every shoot for Walking Dead, is that right?
Every single day. So they were out there in the Atlanta heat. Yep.
Beautiful. So they're as in it as you were.
Absolutely. In some ways, much more.
Great. Now let's just get right into it.
Let's do it. And before we get into your career, we have some serious business to talk here. Now, a little goblin told me, Philly chick, right? You're a DC guy. A huge freaking Eagles fan.
Yeah. I bet, should I watch my dogs? Are you going to start fighting them or something? You and, you and Michael
cold.
Dick? Huh? Is that the next
cold,
step?
Redskins lover. Yeah.
I am a Redskins lover. It's hard being a Redskins fan because I'll say growing up in D.C., you know, the Redskins won the Super Bowl in 83. We went and lost in 84, won in 87, and won in 92. All with different quarterbacks, all with the same coach. And the Redskins. I mean, the Redskins are, and we have just been the worst franchise in football ever since. Ever since Dan Snyder took control. So it's a very sore subject with me. You have no idea how lucky you have it.
No, I feel you. Okay, yeah. We haven't always had it easy either with the Eagles.
That's true. No, that's true. But at least you guys are, you know, you're always in the mix. So
that is true. Yeah. All right. Now I happen to be a big film lover, all different genres, all different kinds. So I do know a little bit about your earlier work, and I want to bring up a couple things that Matt here might not even know. One of my all-time favorites, and I'm biased because I did the show off Broadway in New York for 3 years. Tony and Tina's Wedding. Wow. You weren't expecting that one, right?
I was not. You didn't see that. I didn't know any. You haven't seen the movie, have you?
Yeah, I did.
Nobody's seen that movie. I don't think anybody's seen that movie.
But who did you play?
I played Dominic. I know. I played, and it was. Good God, it was Joey McIntyre, you know, from the New Kids in the Block.
Oh, my gosh.
And Mila Kunis.
That's great.
Mila Kunis played Tina. Yeah, that was fun. Yeah, Adrian Grenier was in it. Is that how you
pronounce
his
name? Yeah, Grenier, that sounds about right.
Yeah, that kid. And it was actually, it was fun. You know, for me, that was my first movie. It was my first, like, sort of big job coming out of school, and I was doing a movie, and it was pretty rad. I think a lot of the other people, the movie kind of crumbled right in front of our eyes in a way, but I loved it, and I was really psyched to be there every day. It was a lot of the people from The Sopranos were in that movie, so it was very cool.
I had to bring that up because you were not going to expect that one.
No, absolutely.
All about throwing
not.
You curveballs.
Yeah,
all about
right?
throwing
right.
you curveballs.
Thanks for that. Thanks for that.
It's more important things now for all the horror fans.
So from there, you jumped into Walking Dead. I don't think you can go any polar opposite than there.
Yeah, right, Tony and Tina.
Yeah, but I mean, like something like this, did you expect like a show about zombies on basic cable to be such a huge success?
You know, man, when I read the pilot script this year, I had never read anything like it before. You know, it was just freaking, I mean, it was just better than everything. You know, I don't want to sound like a douchey actor, but, you know, you get a pilot script and there's that much attention paid to atmosphere and to character, and it blew my mind. And for the first year ever in my career, I mean, I'm just sort of at the start, I'm trying to do what I can do. It was the first time ever I said no to things. And I said, you know, I got offers and I said, I can't take anything until I get to audition for The Walking Dead, because it was just so much better. And I think then when you put Frank Darabont and the AMC and this unbelievably successful comic book and Gail Ann Hurd, when you start putting these pieces together, you start thinking, holy shit, this is some really, really special stuff.
Absolutely.
And so I think we all kind of, everybody was so game, and everybody was so jazzed to be there, and everybody was so excited to be there, and I think everybody knew it was going to be good, but for all the people that do watch it, for them to watch it, he's like bored with what I'm saying here. He's like, all right, I'm talking to Ed. You're boring the hell out of him. He's like flashing the light. But I mean, we never knew it was going to be anything like that. I remember I was talking to Sarah Wayne Callies the night before, and I was like, how many people do you think are going to watch it? And she was like, 2.5, and we were super excited about that. And then when the numbers came out, just kind of blew all of our minds.
That's nuts. That's absolutely nuts.
Nuts.
Like, starting off with a role, something like this, were you familiar with the comic? Like, how much did you know?
You know, I didn't know anything. I knew absolutely nothing about the comic. And again, I just read this script, and it was just so much better than anything else I'd ever read before. And you know, look, I mean, I think, you know, Shane, if, you know, for the people who are fans of the comic, you know, Shane is kind of a two-dimensional character. I mean, he's not very fleshed out. He's gone pretty quick in the comic. And, you know, in the show, I think they've really tried to squeeze as much out of this relationship and out of this guy as they can. And they sort of wanted this kind of conflicted character and this guy who's actually really going through something and the effect that will eventually have on Rick and the family. You know, I think Frank really saw an opportunity there, and it's pretty cool having Kirkman being part of the team, because, you know, it gives you street cred. You know, all those comic book fans can't beat your ass on your way out of Comic-Con.
That's
because
true.
The man is there, and he's saying, hey, look, you know, we might go a little bit different from the comic book, but he's given license. And I think it's a real testament to the kind of artist he is, that he's not sitting there being super precious about his source material, and he's saying, you know, go ahead, let's revisit this stuff, let's see where we can be better at times. And, you know, again, I think it's the mark of a pretty egoless man, you know.
And for you, John, as an actor, and I know this acting myself, you know, sometimes you're offered the opportunity to play these meaty roles you can sink your teeth into.
Yeah, yeah.
When you first read this character, tell me what, you know, drew you to it.
You know, it was on that opening monologue, you know, that was the audition scene. It was pretty, I mean, the whole audition process for this was unlike anything I'd ever been through before. And I ain't just kissing these people's asses because they're my bosses, but like, if they were here, I'd take a nice smooch, because they're really special people. The way Frank Darabont runs his auditions, it's just different than any other kind of television audition. You know, normally you go in and, you know, when you test for a show, you're in front of 100 people in suits, and, you know, they're all kind of deciding by committee. And Frank's not like that at all. He rented a sound stage. We were actually in a police car. He lit it. He shot it. We had real sound. And it was all sort of geared towards, you know, these actors doing their absolute best work. And then he was going to show it to the network. He was going to make up his mind. And he's a very just actor-friendly, artist-friendly director. And I think that's why he works with the same people over and over again, and I think that's why on his set it's all friends of his and buddies of his. But sorry, it's the most long-winded answer ever.
No,
but
I appreciate it.
The answer to your question is, this guy blew my mind. The writing was just, it was so rich, and it could be played million different ways, you know. And I think just the audition process for this was so cool, because you know, strangely enough, I got cast before they had found a Rick. So I got to read with all these guys who were coming in to play Rick. And that was just fascinating for me, to sort of be on the other side. And, you know, it made me fall in love with Frank even more, because I saw how humane he was and how, you know, because auditioning, you know, I think a lot of directors and producers and people in this town kind of get off on the fact that these actors come in and they're super nervous and they're begging for a job. And I think, you know, Frank's the total opposite. He's just there about the work, and it was just pretty cool to sort of witness that and go through that with him.
Wow. Amazing. Awesome. Amazing stuff. Now, Darabont had mentioned that there was a lot of writing changes in the first season. He said that a lot of his actors he went to for inspiration on where he wanted to go with the characters. Mm-hmm. Did you have any input on where Shane went in the latter half of the season?
No. I don't know how much. I mean, look, Frank was doing a ton of the writing, and Frank was just working his ass off back in L.A. while we were doing it in Atlanta. He did have really in-depth conversations with us before we started, and you know, now he's invited us all to the writer's room, and he really wants our input, and it's just the kind of guy he is. He really, I think he casts people, I mean, at least everybody else I can speak for, he casts really smart freaking people, you know, and he really wants people to have insight and to have ideas and to be energetic. And I mean, it's a very, very rare thing, I think, on television where writers are actually collaborating with actors and having them come in and they're open to ideas and open to opinions. And again, I mean, it's just that's the kind of ship that he's running, you know. And it's unlike any other experience I've had. It's the best acting experience I've ever had.
Amazing.
While we're on acting, I have another actor question.
Right on. Let's
do it. You have the role that it's a character that could be killed off at any time.
Yeah.
Would you say?
Yeah, absolutely.
How do you feel about that, both personally and professionally?
Look, I love this show. I want to be on this show as long as I can. So that's one, you know, answer to your question. You brought up freaking Tony and Tina's wedding, and like I said, you know, a lot of the people, like I said, were on The Sopranos, and I got to know a bunch of them, and they told me how there was an atmosphere on that set where they didn't know anybody could get whacked at any time. So you crack open a new script, could be your last, and you never know. And that is very much the case in our show, and I think it does add to the atmosphere that we're trying to create. Any of us can go at any time, and you know, I'm so grateful and excited that they've given Shane so much to kind of express and go through, and it's such a rich character and such a conflicted character that I know that whatever happens with him, it's going to be earned, and he's going to go through it, and it's just been a wild ride. And you know, again, I don't want to just say it because they're my bosses, and I don't want them to kill me, but I know I'm in really good hands, and if it does work out that way, it's going to be a freaking crazy wild ride until it goes down. So that's kind of, you know, that's the sort of bigger answer, you know, not necessarily more political answer. It's just a different answer, you know.
Now, given the roller coaster of just emotions and, I guess, character types that Shane by himself has gone through, I mean, he kind of started off, everyone started vilifying him, and then towards the end of the season, everyone started kind of sympathizing for him. Like, what's the one thing that you hear from fans? I mean, you've got to be considered like one of the villains, like you're the home wrecker, if you will.
Yeah. I mean, my grandma, like after the scene in the woods, my grandma called me up and was like, "Jen," you know, and she's like, you shouldn't be sleeping with that woman in the woods. She's married and you're getting married to," and just like ripped me a freaking apart. I was like, "Yeah," and she's like, and you know, that was hard. You know, AMC has these rules, you know, that, you know, they can basically show anything as far as gore. You can show people getting, you know, pickaxe in the head and stuff. But when it comes to sex, it's very, very, there's very particular rules, you know, and in that sex scene in the woods, you know, one of the particular rules is no thrusting, and you have no idea what it's like to be in a sex scene in the woods. My pants are down in front of the whole crew, and that was the day I met Sarah Wayne Callie's
fun,
beautiful, wonderful husband, and now I have to go into the woods, have a sex scene with her, and I got people screaming at me, "No thrusting!" So you feel like the biggest freaking pervert in the world, you know, you're just trying to, you know, be in the moment or
and
whatever.
And was it in the script, or was it something that was thrown in on set to flip her over halfway through? Was that part of the...
You know what, man?
I gotta ask.
Right on, man. You know, to be honest with you, I'm gonna be totally honest. That was my idea.
Wow.
I talked to the director Michelle about it the week before. You know, I just thought that there would be a really kind of cool moment when he sees the locket, and you know, it's a kind of hard moment for both of them, but they want to continue what they're doing, but it's a lot easier if they don't have to look into each other's face.
Beautiful. That's so great. Wow. Wow. That's excellent. And they all,
yeah,
I mean, it works.
Moment,
such
huh?
a poignant scene,
yeah,
too.
Right. Good God.
Well,
yeah.
I mean, we have another clip from a different scene in the woods, kind of a different take. Definitely no doggy style happening there.
Talking about doggy style, my dog is ripping ass. I mean, it is so nasty.
It's true, everyone.
So I apologize. I'm
Thank
sorry.
You.
I'm
yes,
sorry.
It's totally the dogs.
Oh,
yeah,
by the way,
totally
when we have a sex scene later, no thrusting. The producers
no
told
thrusting.
Me. Ulrich said
thrusting.
No thrusting.
But doggy style is okay.
Dog style.
But you
good.
Can thrust. He just got to yell at you while you're doing it.
Exactly.
So
no thrusting.
Yeah. So, but the answer to your question about being a villain, you know, when we went to New York Comic Con, which was so different from San Diego Comic Con.
Very different.
Very
a little
different.
Colder, too.
Yeah, exactly. But yeah. And in more ways than one, because when I announce, you know, you go down the panel and you announce who you are, everybody booed me, you know, and I was really... that actually made me really excited because, you know, they're loyalists and fans of the comic, and Shane is kind of a villain. And I think what's so cool about the show and what Frank and I really wanted to do is sort of change people's mind episode by episode. And I think that, you know, look, there's no such thing as all bad people or all good people. And I think that's not what Frank does. I think he wants complex. I mean, what we're trying to do in this show is do a zombie show, but set it make it as absolute realistic as we can. There's nothing campy about it. We're not trying to wink at the audience. We're trying to make it a relationship-driven show that's really based in reality. Mm-hmm. And what would you do if you were placed in this situation? And I think it's too easy to just say Shane's a bad guy.
Right.
You know? And personally, I don't think he's that way at all. I think he's the most loyal, honest, good friend in the world. Like, I really do. I think that the circumstances that went down completely complicated thing. And now he's in a situation where it's just
well, there's
too late.
One scene that you could tell that he has that weird battle of conscience. We actually have that clip, so let's roll that clip now. Right. Yeah, here it is. Yep.
If it was your family, you'd feel differently.
What'd you say to me?
I kept them safe, man. I looked after them, but they were my own. That's what I did, man.
I didn't mean it that way.
Well, how'd you mean it? Go on, man. How'd you mean it?
You're misinterpreting me, man.
Right.
You're just hearing it wrong.
Yeah?
Look, you know I can never repay that debt, okay?
Jesus.
I know.
Gonna have to start wearing reflective vests out here. Seriously. Come on, man. Come on, man, let's go. I'm out of here.
So not the best of friends.
Yeah, dude, thanks for that. Just said, most little guy ever, you gotta show me freaking...
Well, man, if I didn't
it's
have...
It's a zombie apocalypse, man. Shit happens, dude. You know what I mean? It's crazy fucking circumstances, you know what I mean?
So in any circumstance, you would just kill the... Would you think that would get it through? Like, oh, zombie shot him in the face. Now we're together forever.
No, and you know what? I think that was really, you know, that was one of those times where that scene could have been played a bunch of different ways. And you know, that's the way that they... That's the take that they decided to use. And I think the point of that scene really is there is no way that Rick could ever understand the lengths that Shane went to in order to save his family and how much they mean to him and how much he's tried to be a father to Carl and how much he's tried to be a lover to his wife. But like he busted his ass to keep them safe for his friends. So, I mean, there's all these different things going on, and I just think it's too simple to just say. And I think he just saw him in his gun, and I think it was more of, wow, he's in my sights now. And it also, I kind of think, hints at the fact that in this society that we're trying to create here, in this atmosphere, there's no laws anymore. There's no rules. Like, you could kill. And I think, hopefully, we're going to see a lot more of that in the next season. I think it's going to get really, really, really freaking dark. And I think that you're going to see that these people are bound by no rules. And eventually, the people will start being far more dangerous than the zombies, which I think really takes from the comic book.
Well, that goes from the book. I mean, absolutely. Everyone always asks whether the title The Walking Dead refers to the actual zombies or the fact that these people are literally living for no reason.
That's it.
They're walking dead.
That's it.
So going back to the love triangle, because I still want to know this stuff. My brain is still surfacing about the fact that you came up with a doggy style. We'll go back to that later.
Yeah.
But that first scene, the one that I guess was part of the audition scene where you're in the cop car with Rick, there's a lot of kind of innuendo that you had something go, or your character, I keep saying you, had something going for his wife before any of the zombies hit.
Mm-hmm,
I mean, is that true? Are we reading too much into it? Do you think that there's there?
No, look, I mean, look, a lot of people have said that, you know, a lot of people have brought that up, and I have my ideas. I think, you know, what they've decided to show from that scene, I think they wanted you to think, you know, look, it's a, they wanted you to think certain things. I think that they're really, the end of the day, it's exactly what they want you to think.
Right.
They want you to wonder, but mm-hmm. it not be completely clear either way. Personally, if he does have any of those feelings, I don't think that it's a conscious thing at all. I think Shane was the kind of guy who would just show up to dinner, you know what I mean? Unannounced, grab a plate, just serve himself, sit down, shoot the shit, talk about all the women he's sleeping with, talk about his crazy life. I mean, I think he was a bachelor, and I think that where he very much sort of secretly, privately, and maybe even subconsciously envied, this is like freaking Inside the Actor's Studio, my freaking backstory on Shane.
No, but I like it,
I
man.
I think that he may have subconsciously envied Rick's life and his peace, but you know, out in the open, he's a guy who gives Rick advice. He's more of a, you know, he's got a million things kind of going on. And I think that, you know, once the apocalypse hits and the shit really hits the fan, he's thrust into this position where he's got to take responsibility for these people. And he's got to be a father to this kid and he's got to keep them safe. And now all of a sudden he's a leader of a group where more naturally, and before, he was really a number two guy, and he took his lead from Rick, and he was much more comfortable in that position. I think what happens is once you get a taste of that power, and once you get a taste of what it's like to have a little kid look at you that way, and have that woman look at you that way, you know, when Rick comes back, it's almost too late because he's had the taste. I think he regrets it immensely, you know, but it's too late at that point. I think that's what makes it such an interesting character to play.
Then you take that triangle and you put it inside the zombie apocalypse.
That's it, man.
And you can't ask for any more.
Right on.
That's true. So, I mean, like we talk about it, the fact that the drama is so big, but one of the huge elements of this is Greg Nicotero's zombie makeup and the effects and stuff.
Yeah.
Some amazing stuff. Now, on the DVD of the Blu-ray set, you can see that he actually does the Zombie School 101, where he actors. Were you there for any of that? Did you get to see that?
It was all during pre-production. Greg Nicotero is, I mean, he is the man.
He is the man.
Did he do your stuff for that?
No, he didn't do it. It was a different company. I've gone to the horror conventions being a screen queen with Greg Nicotero many times. He's super talented and he's a doll. And I really wanted to ask you that too, if you've worked with him hands-on.
Oh, absolutely. He is absolutely just like an essential part. I mean, it's very much his show, and everybody, his team, they're just the most talented people in the world. And I mean, the way these people look, I mean, when the first time that Zombie showed up at lunch, you know what I mean, you're like, what the fuck, like, holy. And you know, Greg plays a bunch of the zombies as well, you know what I mean? And it's just great to kind of be in something where, you know, for between Greg and Frank, they're so unbelievably passionate about this. They've wanted to do something like this for so long. And Robert, obviously, as well. You know, the Zombie School, it's a great example, man. You know, like, it was all going on during pre-production. And people, I mean, it's Atlanta. It's freaking so hot. They're wearing pounds and pounds of makeup. And people were, like, lining up across the block to audition. And, you know, you had to go through zombie movement, zombie theory. And it was funny, I was talking to him, and it was really like trying to pick the people, like picking people. It was like the sort of exact opposite of how most auditions work. You know what I mean?
You get the lifeless ones.
It's not like the super muscular ones or they're like the unbelievably beautiful ones. You know, I think that all the people, all the actors that got to play zombies on the show were so game. They were so in it, and it was just a real tight-knit family, and it was pretty badass, and it's all Greg.
Yeah.
And for the effects fans, are they doing just all makeup effects, or are they doing CG, or are they doing a combination?
It's pretty much, I don't know the answer for sure, but it's got to be 99% all makeup.
Good.
I mean,
old
it's like
school.
it's all old school, and I think that was a big reason why Frank decided to shoot on film the way that he did versus HD or any of the other, you know, different options that are out there, because it just looks so much better on that grainy, you know, 16. So I just think that when you're in the scenes with them, you know, it's going on. It's going on right in front of you. And, you know, Greg makes our job a lot easier, you know?
That's
great. He's awesome.
Now, doggy style scene notwithstanding.
Yeah.
Because I definitely, you are my hero for that alone. Do you have a favorite scene from season one? Do you have like a favorite you, a favorite Shane scene?
A favorite, you know, I don't, I'm looking up on the monitor. It looks like my dog's dead, huh?
There's two zombie dogs.
Just hanging out. Zombie dogs. I love it.
I love you. I'm sorry. Go back to sleep. I know. She stinks. It's her who's farting, not him. You know, man, there's a lot of scenes. There's a lot of, you know, some of my favorite scenes to do, and I don't know how many of them sort of like, you know, I don't know whether there would be a fan's favorite scenes, but I really love the scenes where it's the whole group coming together. The scene where the camp gets invaded by the zombies. The scene where we're going into the CDC, and you know, you don't know it, but there's zombies all around us, sort of coming at us, and we have to get into the building. And it's such a it's such an unbelievable group of actors, and I can't wait till next year. You're going to start seeing way more out of some of the ones that were just sort of on the periphery, and you just see a little bit here and there. These people bring it. They're so game, and they're so good, and when we're a group, an ensemble, and like, you know, to play that sort of collective fear, it's awesome. And I also think that conversely, like, you know, the campfire scenes when we're all just sitting around laughing, that was a really just kind of nice time that I think about, because it was sort of the one light moment of the season.
The
know, before we get attacked, where we're just eating and talking, mm-hmm. and there's very little of that on this show. You know, it's really like high intensity. But, you know, man, I anything that I get to do with Andy or Sarah, you know, it's just they're my partners, they're my friends. They mean so much to me, man, and I love working with them. So, you know, any of those scenes, that scene that you just saw, the scene mm-hmm. in the car, you know,
yeah.
any scene with Sarah, scene down at the water with Carl, as you can see, I just love the show, man.
Yeah, that's
I
really great, man. Yeah. That's excellent to be a part of something, to be that passionate. Yeah.
Thanks, man.
Now, we're talking about season two. Recently, there was Paley Fest, in which uh-huh. you guys had a screening. Were you at that one with Frank and a bunch of other people?
Uh-huh.
Now, he kind of, we had mentioned that he had said a lot of things about season two, one of which is that you're definitely going to the prison, which is a big plot point of the comics.
Yeah, yeah.
You're definitely going there. So are you cool with that? You're cool with being in a giant empty prison? I mean, that's going to be a fun thing.
Yeah, I mean, if anybody knows how to do prisons, it's Frank Darabont.
That's true. You know what I mean? That's true.
He knows what he's doing,
let's hope
know?
Nobody has to crawl through sludge, though. Let's
yeah,
hope that doesn't
right,
have to
right,
happen.
Right, right. Yeah,
another
yeah.
thing you mentioned is we are going to see a few more characters from the comics, and you said you read the first two books. Is
mm-hmm,
that right?
Mm-hmm.
Are there any characters that you personally want to see
in
the show?
Yeah, of course I want to see Michonne, but it's like, you know, I don't, you know, it's weird. I really don't know what is going to happen in season two. You know, I haven't had my meeting with the writers yet. I'm going in on Wednesday. And, you know, I just, I've never been, I can't wait to crack open the first script and see what they've got going, you know, but it's, again, man, it's so rad being in good hands, because I've been in the opposite when you're on something shitty, and it's just the worst. You open it up, you're like, oh, come on, you know, and I can't wait to see where all these characters are going. But yeah, whatever they have in store, I have a feeling it's gonna get super dark, and it's gonna be a crazy season. Plus, we get more than twice as many shows this year, so
that's gonna be great.
Absolutely.
Get their one-off episode, hopefully each character, maybe something
we'll see.
Cool something
yeah.
cool
yeah we'll see
one thing that Frank had mentioned is that this is going this the Walking Dead world exists in a world where zombie pop culture does not exist, which mm-hmm. I thought was really cool. So
really
there's no
cool.
zombie movies,
yep.
there's no zombie comics,
yep.
like, that's
yep.
gonna
yep.
be kind of interesting, because I mean, it avoids self-reference, which is good.
Sure, sure.
But, like, how do you know? There's no, like, if a zombie attacked me, I'd know exactly where to hit him, why to hit him.
You know, I guess it's my own, I guess it's my bad, but I did not know that until the pilot. I was like, well, I wish I knew that for the first season. I did not know that was the case. You know, the way I looked at it, again, was there would be no way for these people to associate if you really went through. I mean, I think one of the fascinating things to me, you know, if you read the book World War Z, you know, it really gets into what it was like, the transformation between regular society and the zombie apocalypse. Like, if you hear about this disease that's going out there and you walk to the supermarket, and on the supermarket you see a guy and you're like, is that a homeless guy? Oh shit, no, that's a zombie, you know? And like, half the people are zombies, and then three quarters of the people are zombies, and you go through that transformation of this disease, you know, to all of a sudden they're everywhere. Stay, baby. That, you know, when you see that they're everywhere, you know, I just can't imagine what that would be like. And I don't think these people look at it as, you know, they're zombies, they're not zombies. You know, I think, I don't want her to go near you because I know you're allergic. Come here, baby.
Thank you.
I love you. I love you. You know, I think that, you know, to them, it's just people who have been infected. You know, I mean, that's how they're looking at it. And you know, it's not, there's just nothing sort of like sci-fi about it. You know, that was my take, but Frank's take makes a lot more sense, I think. Yeah.
Speaking of sci-fi and comics, of course, I think you guys had mentioned earlier that you hadn't been reading the comics or something. Is that correct?
Right, before I read it, yeah.
So do you have any interest in them now?
Or? Sure, absolutely. In getting to know Robert and being on the show, yeah, I love the comic. I think it's great.
Okay.
And I mean, I've gotten into some of the other ones from Image, but yeah, I dig it. I dig it a lot.
Nice.
Yeah.
Interesting. Now, I know, you know, you got a bad rap for about 5 episodes of being the bad guy, kind of the bad guy, but we finally get to see the light side of you, and we go back to you and Rick actually being friends. We actually have a clip that proves that you're actually not so bad guy. Not
nice,
such,
man.
Not
yeah,
such,
let's see
not
that
such
one,
a dick.
Man. Let's
take a look.
One.
Let's show that one.
Listen to me, if you're gonna wake up, I need you to do it now. Okay, now. Please, man, you just show me a sign, anything. Please, Rick.
So right there, I mean, that shows that you're kind of a good guy, right? Like, you helped him out, and we were talking over the clip, like, while I was playing. Like, that wasn't the whole scene. Like, that was just a 3-minute cold open at the beginning of episode 6.
Right. Yeah, I mean, it's crazy because they definitely made some big decisions on what they were going to show from that. That scene when we shot it and the way it was written was actually about 10 times longer, and there's a scene where when I'm running out, I actually get confronted by a soldier, and he puts a gun on me, and I say I'm a cop, and he says, well, where's your red tag, because anybody, or where's your green tag, because anybody in the hospital, you either need to wear a green tag or a red tag, because those people that were being executed, even though they were still healthy, there are people who had been infected, and then a zombie comes out, and the soldier shoots the zombie in the stomach, I shoot the zombie in the head. So it's just sort of to lend, kind of, to show sort of, we're still trying to all figure this thing out, and then but it also goes into, when I go back in the room, I think they really wanted to stress that I listen to his heartbeat and don't hear anything. And there was another sort of way that scene was playing where I couldn't figure out whether he was dead or not.
Right.
And I actually put a gun to his head.
Oh, wow.
And yeah, I'm probably going to get in a lot of trouble for saying that.
No, I'm sure a lot of this stuff is on the DVD and
yeah,
the Blu-ray,
probably,
which hits this week.
But it was just a different way to go. And then I just broke down crying because I couldn't do it.
Oh,
and
wow.
I
so
thought
really
about killing
scene.
Myself. It was a super intense
because the way
scene,
they cut it, you kind of like, you try to pick him up and then you look at all the machinery, you're like, meh.
What
and you kind of leave.
yeah, you know, and it's like, but once that sort of big, you know, explosion goes outside and I see the machines go down, I listen to his heartbeat, I don't hear anything, and then I leave, you know? And like I said, it was just sort of a much more sort of traumatic, intense thing on a different take. But I think the thing they really wanted to stress was that he didn't hear a heartbeat.
Interesting.
Yeah. I got a chick question. What's that? Of course, I want to talk about love.
Right on.
Let's talk about your love triangle and Lori's huge secret. Okay. I know you said you can't talk a lot about next season, but can you tell us anything for all the chicks that are watching for next season? What's going on with the love triangle?
Wow, it's not even that. I don't know. I really don't know. I don't know what her secret is. I don't know. I don't know where it's gonna go. I really don't. And I know that. I think Sarah Wayne Callies is such a badass actress, and I think that, you know, there's so much that she's able to capture in just a look and in just these little moments. And I think next season it's gonna explode. I think my ass is in for some serious trouble. But I don't
drama.
Know. Yeah, like yeah. But it. I don't know what's gonna go down. I really don't. I know everybody at the Paleys was talking about, you know, her potentially being pregnant. I don't know if that's going to happen or if that's not going to happen.
It seems too easy. It seems like it's too easy. Like, that just seems...
You know, it's from the comic. You know, I mean, that's the only reason I'm saying, you know, that's why people are expecting it. It's because it's from the comic. But
if anybody who saw the last two episodes, I mean, they're going drastically in the opposite direction.
Absolutely. Yeah, there's no CDC in the comic. Yeah. So,
for the best. I mean, it works out, and it's excellent. It's really cool stuff. So we talked about what Frank is working towards for season two. Is there one thing that you really want to see in season two? Now that you're, I mean, you're a fan of the show, obviously. Mm-hmm. You're a fan of the comics.
Yeah.
Is there one thing you would really want to see?
You know, I mean, it's such a shitty answer, but I just want to see more of the same. I really want to see I love the fact that now they're going to be in a much more kind of just rogue state. Like, the camp was great, but I love the fact that now they're going to come across different, these little, like the Vatos, they're going to have to come across these sort of pockets of society, and I think it's just going to be really dangerous. And I do think eventually, like I said before, they're going to be able to deal with the zombies a lot better than the different people they meet. So I would love to see the governor. I would love to see Merle come back. You know, I just...
Maybe one isn't mutually exclusive to the other.
Who knows, man?
We don't know?
I don't know, man. Who knows? But Michael Rooker is something else, man.
Yeah, that's why everyone that we talk to who's worked on the set with him, he's just a blast.
Yeah, everybody, man. Everybody. And I love, you know, I love the character of Daryl Dixon. You know, it's just like Norman Reedus is just, he's such a monster, you know what I mean? I love that kid so much. And I mean, everyone. I also really, I'm also really interested to see what happens with Dale. I think Jeffrey DeMunn is just I think he's a treasure of an actor. And I love the fact that, unlike in the comics, he's the one who caught Shane pointing the gun at Rick. And I think he's just got this very, he's just always watching. He always knows what's up.
He's got some of the best eyebrow expressions I've ever seen.
He's got
those crazy eyebrows.
Those awesome eyebrows. Yeah, he dreadlocks those things,
man. It works
for
him. Yeah, it absolutely right works. On, right on. So now, we know that you're going to be starting season two soon down in Atlanta. What else are you working on right now?
I finished a movie that actually Boss and Venice were in.
No kidding.
Venice has a really, really great part in it. It's called Rampart. It's Oren Moverman's new movie. He did The Messenger 2 years ago. It was nominated for Best Picture, and it had Woody Harrelson and Ben Foster. And this, too, is starring Woody Harrelson. And it's got Steve Buscemi and Ice Cube and Robin Wright, Sigourney Weaver, Ned Beatty, John Foster, Ben Foster. Great, great, gritty movie, an Elroy movie based on the Rampart scandal. It's sort of set in the Rampart scandal. Woody just, he kills this movie. And it was really, really awesome. Really, really fun movie to be a part of. I play a cop again.
It works, right?
I guess so, man. I guess so, yeah.
Just not in the zombie apocalypse in this one.
Yeah, exactly.
It's a good cop. Maybe not so much doggy style in this one either. Maybe. I don't know. There could be. You have to go find out. You have to go see the movie to find out.
No doggy style.
No doggy style. And no thrusting.
No thrusting.
Excellent. Well, John, I want to thank you for coming on the show.
Thanks
for having me. I appreciate it, man. Absolutely.
Thank you
so much.
I appreciate it.
And because you are here, and this is our zombie episode, we've got our zombie dummy in the house, which is awesome.
Yeah. I see that. I want to whack it in the fucking head. I hate zombies so much.
I hope not. We have to bring back. We actually have our top five this week, which is zombie centric, which is our top five zombies. Zombies are personalities. Let's take a look.
They're coming to get you, Barbara.
Stop it. You're ignorant.
They're coming for you, Barbara.
That is enough.
Well, if you're not going to dance with me, I know someone who will.
Don't dance there. discuss sin or paramedics.
Some great stuff. Some absolutely amazing zombies. And I know we had our top five, but deep down in my heart, you're my number one zombie.
You are. And you're my number one host.
So I know we're talking Stacy's not in the house, but over the weekend we did get to do some kind of zombie extracurricular activities.
I heard.
Yes. What do you know about The Re-Animator?
The movie.
The movie.
The show based on the movie. I'm so bummed I missed it.
Yes, we actually got to go see Re-Animator the musical, which is amazing.
I can't wait to see it.
Absolutely amazing. George Wendt was in the film, Cheers fame. Yeah, pretty amazing.
I missed that.
And it's a musical, a lot of great stuff. I mean, we got to go and we got to interview everybody, and it was a blast. And Stacy actually, she sent us a little package because she got to interview some people. So let's take a look at that right now.
She's the best, our girl.
Stacy Lane Wilson here with
Matt Robb.
And we are at
Re-Animator the Musical.
Hello, I'm Stuart Gordon. I'd like to welcome you to the set of Re-Animator the Musical. And it's going to be running here at the Steve Allen Theater in Los Angeles until the end of March.
Graham, you play Herbert West, who's an iconic character in the Re-Animator films.
You'll never get credit for my discovery. Who's going to believe a talking head? Get a job in a sideshow.
So how did this role come to you?
Well, it came to me through George Wendt, and he recommended me for the role, and I got it. And, you know, it's amazing. I've been a fan of the movie for a long, long time. And so filling Herbert West's shoes there were big shoes to fill. Yeah.
Do you know if Jeffrey Combs has seen your performance yet?
Apparently he saw a DVD of the reading that we did back this summer. But he's coming tomorrow night for opening. So I'm very excited to get to meet him. I've never met him before.
Will you be thinking about that? Like when you're performing, is it all just in your mind that you're Herbert West?
No, I mean, you gotta be focused and if you're having fun, like how can you not have fun when you're spraying bloody intestines on people? And, you know, I'm hoping to hit him. Maybe I'll hit him with some bloody intestines.
Yeah, well, we did notice that you were actually hitting one person in particular quite a bit tonight. What's up with that? Any kind of a rivalry?
No. That poor person, whoever sits in that seat every night, I just get him. And it's also who squeals the most. It's always who squeals the most. So if you come and see the show, squeal more, and I will spray you more.
No matter how much blood we have, they always say more blood.
More blood.
Yeah, that's right. And tonight, I think they, you know, wouldn't have been happy unless they were able to swim out of here. No, it's a wild bunch, and we have the first three rows, we call it the splash zone, so they are given garbage bags to wear to protect them, and they got pretty soaked, I have to say.
Now, are you the type of director who immerses himself in such an experience? Did you actually get drenched at any point?
You know, actually, I'm a total chicken, so I was sitting way in the back, you know, I was like, you know.
Now, we're curious to know, actually very curious, all of us, to know why Re-Animator, out of all of the fantastic works that you've done, why would you like to revisit this one in particular on the stage?
Well, there's something about it, it's very compact, you know, it's like it's just got a few characters and a few locations, so it kind of lends itself to the stage. You know, some of the other movies, you know, they're going here and there and, you know, casts of thousands, but this is a very kind of simple little story, and it works as a musical.
Simple, bloody, gory, dismemberment, sex, drugs, rock and roll.
It's got it all.
So in working with Stuart Gordon, who is an iconic director in the genre, what's it like working with him in a live performance?
Unbelievable. I mean, he's a wonderful director. You know, I've also been a fan of his work for a long time, and getting to work with him on such a close basis and you know, it's amazing. Stuart is so calm and so chill, and he's so driven. He always knows exactly what he wants. But he's open to ideas. You know, it's really a collaborative process with him, and it's really been amazing. I mean, he's been a true mentor throughout this process.
Who are some of your castmates in this play? You've got some great people to bounce off of. We already talked about George.
Oh, yes. I mean, there's the wonderful Jesse Merlin playing Dr. Hill, who I love to... I was telling him that every time he walks on stage, I'm thinking, you smug son of a bitch. Yeah, of course, Chris McKenna and Rachel Avery playing the lovebirds, Dan and Meg. Who are just great to play off of. And an amazing chorus of people that I swear they have the hardest job in the show. I mean, they are constantly working. It's really amazing. They're the headless corpses and spraying us with blood and throwing cats on us.
Well, I feel like this is, you know, Re-Animator has reanimated me to some degree, which is really fun. You know, coming back to it after all these years is really a pleasure. And, you know, kind of doing a different spin on it with the music, I think, is really, I've loved working with Mark Nutter. You know, he's a brilliant, brilliant composer.
Mark, you say eat it in the music business? I didn't know that.
Just the mic. Please don't take that out of context.
There is some kind of interesting almost eating scene in this play involving a disembodied head, which is from the film.
Yes, yeah. There's, you know, everybody knows it. My particular pleasure was that I got to write a song for it. So the head sings at a key moment.
It's kind of sick and cheerful at the same time. I guess is the way I would describe it.
Now, how did you decide what type of music you would do for Re-Animator? Because you could do like punk rock, you could do like Broadway. I mean, how did you guys decide how it would be?
It just kind of happened. I'm not so much of a rock guy. I would say the biggest things that influenced me were Sweeney Todd, Phantom, and Bernard Herrmann. You know, of course, Bernard Herrmann influenced Sondheim for Sweeney Todd, so it's more of that world rather than a rock or pop score.
I have to say, I absolutely love that sort of musical dance number with the zombies, which is kind of an homage to Michael Jackson's Thriller.
Yes. Yeah, it was sort of a tip of the hat to John Landis, who directed that video. And I'm hoping he's going to come and see the show, so unless he sues us for it.
Yeah. And Mick Garris and Cynthia Garris were also in that video, Thriller. Have they seen your show yet?
They're coming tomorrow night. With Joe Dante, as a matter of fact. So we're going to have, and some of the original cast from Re-Animator will be here tomorrow, Barbara Crampton and Jeffrey Combs.
You talk a little bit about sort of the different gratification that you get from directing a film like Re-Animator as opposed to a play, where you get sort of an immediate response.
That's
and
exactly
you can evolve.
It. Yeah, it's that give and take that you have with the audience. You know, when you're working on a movie, it can be kind of a lonely experience sometimes. You don't get that audience usually it's like a year, and you know, after you started working on the film. But with theater, it's so immediate, and it is that kind of, it's back and forth. You know, the audience is a character in the play, and they cheer on the actors to do even crazier and wilder things.
We have some really crazy and wild songs in this. I have to say, I'm probably going to be humming a lot of them on the way home. Now, what song, if you had to sing any one of these songs night after night on stage, would you pick and why?
I Will Be Famous, just because I have an empathy with Dr. Hill for some reason.
Is that song that Dr. Hill sings, If You're Ever Lonely, which I love. Yes, yeah, and he does that reprise later on when she's strapped down to the table. And, you know, Jesse Merlin is amazing. He's really great in that role.
What kind of makeup is required for the zombies in this show?
They have these amazing masks that were put together by the whole special effects team that did the film, you know, that came back. And really, if you watch the film, it's pretty exact to what they were in the movie. But
what's next for you, Stuart? Bride of Re-Animator?
I don't
see Brian here in the
audience. Yeah, Brian is here. I don't know. I mean, it was funny. I was kidding Mark. I said we should do From Beyond the Musical next.
There you go.
Yes.
Get some tentacles in there.
I know. It would be kind of goopy, you know, as opposed to bloody.
I knew that one audience reaction has consistently been more blood. And so
more blood.
And so more blood you shall have.
It was such a blast. It was such a blast. Like, it really was. And then he mentions more blood. Like, the first two rows had to wear rain ponchos because they have, similar to what you have in your hand, some intestine that shoot just this goopy blood all over the audience. It is a blast, and it is running all throughout March, so you definitely got to go check it out.
We're going to go check it out,
oh,
right?
We're going to go again.
Okay,
yeah,
we'll go
we're going to go. We're definitely going to go. So I think that kind of runs out. That's our whole time today. That was a blast. I had such a good time, and I want to thank Miss Vampy a.k.a. Brooke Lewis. Now, before we go, since I have you here,
yes.
You were telling me that you have won a Golden Cob Award.
I did. How crazy is that?
What is that?
I don't even know. I've been acting for so long, and I did Greg Lamberson's movie Slime City Massacre, which was a sequel to a 1988 cult classic Slime City for all the real horror sci-fi fans. It's like a horror sci-fi action kind of little thing. Kind of like, I mean, you know, along the lines of what we talked about tonight, comic book style. He did all the Johnny Gruesome novels, so for all those fans, it's very stylized in that way. And they're not slime zombies per se, but for now, for the sake of the show, we can say they are. So think about that, slime zombies. Mm-hmm. And so I did Slime City Massacre. I played Nicole, and I was nominated and won the B Movie Golden Cob Award 2010 for Best Scream Queen of 2009. So I won the award in September of last year.
That's a big name.
Yes, and what an honor.
That's
and it
excellent.
Was, thank you.
Well, congratulations.
Thank you so much. Oh, and speaking of awards, Slime City Massacre, I will announce, because Greg just emailed and called last week, and we won one of the Pollies, and I'm wasn't familiar with this, but the Polished Apple Awards. And apparently it's an award show that they do both studio pictures and independent films as well in horror and all different genres. Like, for example, Denzel Washington's The Book of Eli won like Best Ensemble Cast. What was the remake? Clash of the Titans won Best Remake. And we got a call and email that we won for Best Sequel of 2010, or 2011, actually.
That's great.
2011 Slime City Massacre. So this little movie that could has been, stars Debbie Rochon, mm-hmm. Lee Perkins, Jennifer Bill, Kaelin Patrick Burke, Robert Sabin, Mary Bogle, all the, some of the originals.
And Ms.
Original
Vampy.
And Brooke Lewis, Ms. Vampy. So it's been a wild ride.
That's crazy.
And yeah, it's been really great. And it's actually coming out. Finally, it gets released through Media Blasters. We will be on VOD and DVD May 10th. Everybody check it out.
May
it's our street date. Yeah, street date is May 10th.
Very
soon.
Cool. We actually have a trailer.
Yeah.
I haven't even seen these. So I have to see this
Ooh,
trailer. Show us the trailer.
Thank you so much.
Of course.
By possessing the living, we will live for eternity.
What makes you think there's nobody in here?
Well, I'm sure there are people in here, but if they can survive, then so can we.
Oh! Scream again, you'll be gargling your own blood.
What the hell?
Zachary Devon, homebrewed elixir.
Oh, so bad. Corey, look at me.
Zachary and his followers have been possessing people for decades.
She has used and abused her body. Now she'll learn to use her flesh.
Flesh.
So our Himalayan yogurt is actually ectoplasm. It's the residue of a spirit. When taken alone, the elixir expands consciousness. But when you combine it with ectoplasm, it releases the personality of the spirit that produced ectoplasm. Stage one, possession, fills the host with the urge to kill. Stage two allows the spirit to temporarily take over the host. There's a good chance that if we experience stage three, we're gonna disappear forever.
Crazy bastard!
City.
And the titular line makes it into the trailer. How cool is that?
There
that was
go.
Awesome.
Thank you.
I can't wait to see that.
Good,
really
I'm glad.
Can't. And when
I
does that hit again?
That's May 10th. Street dates May 10th. Media Blasters. Check it out. VOD and DVD, everybody.
Beautiful. Excellent. Well, Ms. Vampy, yes. Ms. Brooke Lewis, I want to thank you so much for coming on the show tonight.
Thank you for filling in, Matt.
I really appreciate it.
I appreciate you guys having me here. I had the best time.
Excellent. Hopefully
I'll be invited back when Stacey's out on a big press junket.
You'll be back. Absolutely. And I want to thank all of you for watching our show. Thank you guys so much. And join us next week because we are going all po, yo. That's right. We got some amazing guests. You're not going to want to miss out next week. It goes nuts. And I have to tell you, if you want our show to keep going, you got to go onto iTunes, subscribe to our show, comment on our show, make sure that you keep the show going. Because I'm telling you, if you love us, tell us. We need to know these things. I'm very sensitive, and I need affirmation at all times. At all times. This guy does too. Look at him. So that's our show for tonight. Thank you guys so much, and join us next Monday as we will be here live. For Brooke Lewis, I'm Matt Robb. Take care.
What about our sex scene? We got to go do it.
We'll go do it now.
No thrusting.
No thrusting.
No thrusting. Producer, say no.
No thrusting.